Okay. So we come on to Mughals were followers of Islam. Like their Turkish counterparts, they applied religious laws in functioning of the government. Akbar, however, followed a liberal religious policy. Please underline Akbar and underline liberal religious policy. Now, when the Mughals came, they also were following the laws laid down by their religion. There's a lot of noise in the center part, backside. The call is getting recorded. I don't want these two girls. Please shift that side. Every time when I enter, I have to check you for your place, being very close to her. We put your bag this side. Both of you put your bags in the center and move towards the corner. Akbar with liberal religious policy. Now pay attention. He was a king. Akbar was a king who followed the liberalism. That means he was liberal in his attitude, in his approach. He used to be very clear about the fact that equal importance is given to Hinduism as well as Islam. Clear, he was liberal. He was okay with the other religion. Okay, he was not rigid. Clear? He believes that every religion was basically good. He was influenced by the liberal ideas of the Sufi saints. He used to hold talks with the leaders of various religions. He also constructed a building called Ibadat Khana, please underline that, Hall of Worship near Fatehpur Sikri, Agra, to hold discussions with religious leaders. So he was so liberal, he was so ready to accept other religions that he also constructed a building which was known as Ibadat Khana, and which was a part where you all can come, when all people from a different religion could come, and he used to head these meetings and incorporate the good qualities of every religion and work on it. Clear? The place was in Fatehpur Sikri, Agra. Okay? Okay. He opened the doors of the Ibadat Khana to Hindus, Christians, Zoroastrians, and Jains. No single religion was allowed any kind of monopoly. So now he was liberal towards all religion. At the same time, he said that there's no one religion who's going to hold all in all power. The monopoly, that means to have all in one religion. That means only since I'm the ruler, I'm the follower of this religion, so that this particular religion can only have every privilege. No, all were given equal status. Clear? During the religious courses at the Ibadat Khana, Akbar found out that basically all religions taught similar things. Thus, he incorporated the principles of all the religions to find a new faith, which he named as Deen-e-Ilahi, underline Deen-e-Ilahi. Now, this was the religion, not exactly a religion, but the principles based on good values from all the religions. So what he did was, he took the good points of all the religions and incorporated in this unknown and called it as Deen-e-Ilahi. That means path leading towards Allah. Okay? Akbar's successors, Jahangir and Shah Jahan, also followed this policy of toleration. But when Aurangzeb tried to change the multi-religious fabric of the state, it adversely affected the fate of the Mughal Empire. So, after Akbar, Jahangir and Shah Jahan, these two also were liberal kings. They also followed lenient policies towards other religion. But it was when Akbar Aurangzeb came to power, he was the one who was a staunch Muslim ruler, and he did not allow other religions to flourish that way. Now, when this happened, the people around did not like it. and it was then that the downfall of the Mughal Empire began. Clear till here? Now we come on to the Bhakti movement and then followed by the Sufi movement. Now these were the two movements which were prevalent in the medieval period. Why? Because of the Hinduism turning very staunch and rigid, and because of the Islam being very staunch and rigid. Because of Hinduism being staunch and rigid, there came Bhakti movement. Because of Islam being staunch and rigid, came the Sufi movement. Okay? So let us see the Bhakti movement. The word Bhakti means devotion or love for God. Please underline the meaning. Devotion or love for God. Its teachings did not believe in caste discrimination or caste hatred. Its followers are divided into two groups. Those believing God having a form are called Saguna, and those believing God as formless are called Nirguna. Please underline Saguna and Nirguna. Now, Sagun means they gave shape and idolized God. Bhakti movement was very simple. It talked about good qualities. It talked about one God. But there were two divisions. Some of them, they gave a face and a figure to whom they are praying, and those are called Sagun. Then the second part was those who believe that God is everywhere and we cannot create him in a kind of a mold or a structure. So that was Nirgun. That means unko har cheez mein Ishwar dikhte the. So they decided they would not give a shape and form to the image of a God. Okay? So those were called Nirgun. Now the followers of Saguna Bhakti worshipped their gods in different forms and in various incarnations. So these the Sagun Bhaktas, the Bhaktas, they believed that God came as Avatara and they were in various incarnations and they idolized it and praised them. Okay? Whereas the followers of Nirgun Bhakti consider God as omnipresent and residing in every heart. So as I told you, they believe God is present everywhere and every soul, every human, every living creature has a part of God in them. Okay? Now both types of followers had some common points. Both believed in Upanishadic philosophy of Advaita or non-duality of God. Advaita, please underline, which means non-duality of God. Now let me explain this. In spite of their ways of worshipping were different, one they idolized God and the other they found God in everything. Clear? Sagun and Nirgun. Yet there was a common factor which they worked on, and that was that the Advaita, that means there's only one supreme God. There's no double, there are no two, three gods. One supreme God, and that is called Advaita. Clear? They both believed that. Now, all the Bhakti saints laid emphasis on attaining true knowledge from a guru. Please underline this. Attaining true knowledge from a guru. So they thought that any Bhakti is only and only possible if all believe in the fact that there is one God, and that could be only attained by knowledge from a guru. That means once a preacher or a teacher tells you the path leading towards God, only then you can attain that. Clear? Now, basic principles. This part is very important because it tells you what the basic principles were when we talk of Bhakti movement. Okay, let us read it. During the medieval period, the movement spread to the whole of India. Its basic principles were following. Number one, a loving relationship between a devotee and his personal God. Now, praying is a personal method. Nobody can check you how you're praying. You're standing, you're sitting, you're lying down on a bed. You can pray. You can talk to God in any form. That is totally and totally you and God, the Creator. Nobody else can come in between that and your worship. Okay? Number two, discarding of rituals and sacrifices as modes of worship. Now, earlier it was believed that only when you give that much of sacrifice, only when you do this much of rituals, only then you can attain God. Now, when Bhakti movement came, it said, no, you talking to God the way you want is okay. You need not have to have an, you know, pura proper rituals performed with a ghee and tail and diya and bati and all that. No, that nothing is needed. By singing hymns, by dancing around, no. You could simply sit and you can simply talk in a normal language to God and he'll hear you. This is what they believed in. Clear? Third point, purity of heart and mind and kindness. So they believed that your heart should be pure. Your approach towards God should be very pure and clean. Clear? Then they said that mind, your heart not only, but your mind should also be equally free from all. Man mein aapke dimag mein kuch aur chal raha hai and you're praying, just narrating the mantras. It will not be effective. You have to do it with full concentration and purity. Clear? And then the last thing they said, kindness. As we all know, if we pray to God regularly and we come here and talk rubbish, we hurt each other, we kill each other, we stab each other, is it called kindness? Do you think we'll be closer to God? No. So the Bhakti movement emphasized on being kind, on being giving, on being helpful towards each other. Next point, disregarding of any discrimination based on gender, caste, or creed. That means any difference on the basis of caste, religion, creed, culture should be disregarded. Should not be taken into account. Clear? This is what they talked of. Next, brotherhood of mankind. Not just your own brother should be called and treated as brother. Every single individual. Kehte na, hum sab bhai hai. Hum sab ek hai. We say na? So let the spirit of brotherhood spread. This is what they wanted. Clear? Next point. The points are over. Next paragraph. The Bhakti movement in India is responsible for many changes introduced in the worship of God by the Hindus, the Muslims, the Sikhs. For example, Kirtan at a Hindu temple, Qawwali at a Dargah, and singing of Gurbani at a Gurudwara are all derived from Bhakti movement. So you can underline this. The changes in the ways were like the Kirtans were sent, the praises of God was sung by the people, and it was done in the Hindu temples. And in Muslim areas, it was the Qawwali which was performed. And in Gurudwaras, even till today, we can hear the Gurbani. Okay? So these were all the ways which the Bhakti movement had told. Now next is reasons for the success. By who's talking? Reasons for the success of Bhakti movement. Why was Bhakti movement a successful movement? Let us see. Number one, the Bhakti saints preached in the popular local language of the people. Underline local language. Now the language in which the people spoke, the saints, they spoke local language. Now local language was understood by everyone. Had they been in Sanskrit, it would have not been understood by the people who are not that learned or educated. Clear? Like supposing our local language is Hindi. We talk to each other in Hindi when we are at home or when we are relaxed. Imagine, Karo, if the preaching is done in English, half of the Indian crowd who is illiterate, will they be able to understand it? No. So this is the case. In the earlier times, the preaching was done in Sanskrit, which was not understood by many, because the local language at that time was much simpler. So it was not understood. So that is why when Bhakti movement came, it spread and taught people in the local language. Okay? So that was one important principle why it got successful. Okay? Now, Hindi, Marathi, Bengali, Uriya, Assamese, Telugu, and Kannada. These were the languages which were used by the saints to preach the Bhakti movement principles. Okay. Next, number two, they emphasize simple ways for a realization of God, underlined simple ways. Their ways and methods were very simple as compared to the rituals, ceremonies, and great and big pompous sacrifices. Okay? Number three, at the time when society had become polarized, they discarded caste, color, creed, and gender-based bias. Now, please underline, disregarded caste, color, creed, gender-based bias. Now, it was the time when because of Hinduism, the castes had turned very rigid. But with the coming of Bhakti movement, they treated everyone as equal, irrespective of what color you belong to, what caste you belong to, how rich you are, how fair you are, irrespective of everything. They took every individual as equal to the other individual. Yeah? Next point. Different saints spread the movement in different corners of the country. Underline different corners of the country. That means every saint made it possible to spread it in whole India. Whichever saint was living in whichever area, he made it sure that he spread it through to all the other subordinating areas. That is why Bhakti movement spread all over India. Yeah? Next, important Bhakti saints. Again, this heading is very important. Now, the important Bhakti saints are Ramanuja, Ramananda, Kabir, Namdev, Guru Nanak, Vallabhacharya, Chaitanya, and Mirabai were some of the great reformers of the Bhakti movement. Ramanuja was born, we'll take each one. First is Ramanuja. Ramanuja was born in a town near Madras, that is Chennai. He preached the worship of Vishnu. He won many followers in South India. Now, please underline the town Madras, where he was born. Then he preached and worshipped of Vishnu, underline Vishnu. And then he had followers in the South India, underline South India. Clear? Next, Ramananda was born at Allahabad, underline Allahabad, in the Brahmin family. He was the first reformer to preach in Hindi, underline first reformer, underline Hindi. He preached in the North, please underline North. One of his disciples was Kabir. Kabir was his follower. That means Ramanand jo the, wo sabse pehle preacher the North India. Okay? The place where we live, Northern India. Next is Kabir. Kabir was most popular reformer of the Bhakti movement, underline most popular. He was weaver by profession, underline weaver by profession. He had firm faith in Hindu-Muslim unity, underline Hindu-Muslim unity. And thousands of his disciples came from both these communities. He believed in Nirguna, underline Nirguna form of Bhakti. That means God is present everywhere. Okay. He was a famous disciple of Ramanand, underline famous disciple Ramananda. His couplets or dohas are still recited everywhere in India, underline couplets or dohas. Yeah, his way of practice, dohas, he wrote dohas, and they are still recited. Yeah. Next is Sant Janeshwar, began the Bhakti movement in Maharashtra, underline Maharashtra. He wrote a commentary on Bhagavad Gita in Marathi, underline commentary, Bhagavad Gita, Marathi. In the local language of Maharashtra, that is Marathi, he wrote the commentary, that means he dictated all what was said in Gita, Bhagavad Gita. Clear? Namdev was a Maratha saint, underline Maratha saint. He preached oneness of God, underline oneness of God, for all the religion. He had many Muslim followers as well, underline Muslim followers. Other prominent Bhakti saints of Maharashtra were Sant Tukaram and Ramdas, underline Sant Tukaram and Ramdas. So whatever we learned, we came to know that only Ramananda and Kabir, they were from North India. Ramanuja, he was also from South, then Maharashtra, Sant Janeshwar, Namdev, they were also, Maharashtra is in South. So these were the South saints and plus Tukaram and Ramdas. Yeah? Then we talk of Guru Nanak. Guru Nanak was an important Bhakti saint. His teachings were later collected in Guru Granth Sahib. Please underline that, Guru Granth Sahib. Whatever he taught, his disciples wrote all the teachings and they compiled and formed a book which was known as Guru Gobind Sahib. Guru Granth Sahib, sorry. It's a holy book of Sikhs. Next, Vallabhacharya. Vallabhacharya preached the worship of Lord Krishna, underline Lord Krishna. He said that there is no difference between the Atma and Paramatma. Underline no difference, underline Atma, Paramatma. Such a doctrine is called Advaitvad. I told you Advaitvad, that means one single God, there's no two supreme powers. Okay, so he said Atma and Paramatma, there's no difference between them. Atma is a part of Paramatma. That means Atma, our soul, is a part of God, which goes and reunites with God once we are dead. Okay? Next, Chaitanya was born in Nadia, underline Nadia, in 1485, please underline the year. He was a devotee of Lord Krishna, underline Lord Krishna, and preached universal brotherhood and love, underline universal brotherhood, underline love. Next is Mirabai, was a Rathor princess, underline Rathor princess. From her childhood, she was a great devotee of Krishna, underline Krishna. She contributed a lot in popularizing the Bhakti movement. Mirabai ke gaane sune honge na, it was all in praises of Krishna, Lord Krishna. Next is Narsi Mehta. Also known as Narasimha Mehta, underline his other name, Narasimha Mehta. He popularized the Bhakti movement in Gujarat, underline Gujarat. His songs in Gujarati depicting divine love of Radha and Krishna are still very popular. So he talked of the divine love which Radha had for Krishna, and his songs are basically dealing with those incidents. He was a popular saint of Gujarat. Next, Surdas and Tulsidas were great saint poets, underline saint poets. They wrote a number of poetries. Surdas was a devotee of Krishna, underline Surdas, Krishna. Tulsidas worshipped Rama, Ram ko. He used to pray Ram for Ram. The poems of Surdas were later compiled as Sur Sagar, underline Sur Sagar. All his work, Surdas's work, is compiled in a collection called Sur Sagar. Okay? Tulsidas is the author of Ramcharitmanas, underline, and many other works, including Hanuman Chalisa. Hanuman Chalisa was also written by Tulsidas. Clear? Ramcharitmanas and Hanuman Chalisa, both are written by Tulsidas. What Surdas did, it was compiled, his work is compiled in Sur Sagar. Okay, now we come to the case study of Sant Kabir. That means we are going to read in detail about Kabir. Okay, how much time is left? So we stop here, we'll begin it in our next class.